Despite being considered a pixel junkie of sorts who can't get enough of the highest resolution everything for pretty much my entire life, or at least, you know, the past 5 or 10 years, I am leaving 4K, at least on the desktop side. In this video, we're going to talk about why. TunnelBear is the fast and easy VPN service that keeps your data safe and secure behind a bear. Sign up for your 7-day free trial and learn more via the link in the video description. Alright, well, this is take 2 of me recording this video. I'm EposVox, here to make tech easier to understand and more fun. Who forgot to select the right audio track to record for a 20-minute original recording of the video. Maybe we'll make it snappier here. By the way, since I thought it would be funny, just a little jab, if I used this video as the test video for me to test out a new ELP branded webcam I'm using. It's manual focus and everything, so I'm using a big studio light to try to brighten it up. Hopefully everything looks okay. I do look a little pasty pale here, but that is what happens when you shine a giant LED in your face. But we're going to be talking about why I am abandoning 4K as a desktop monitor format, and I have a few reasons why. And again, I'm not abandoning 4K for my videos. Obviously, this is a 1080p one, but for the most part, they will stay 4K. I'm not abandoning 4K media consumption, and I might still dabble in 4K gaming from time to time. But Windows absolutely sucks for 4K. And Linux is even worse for those of you who like to give me crap about using Windows, even though I need to for work and for my videos and for Adobe and things like that. Windows sucks at it. So I started using 4K back in summer of 2015. I got a monoprice. It's a Crystal Pro 28-inch 4K monitor. It was on sale for under $400 at the time. That was the deal, like the biggest deal on 4K you could ever get. It's clearly a budget panel. So I got that. A few months prior, I had just picked up a 1440p 0G monoprice monitor. And these are two completely different generations of monoprice product, and I will go over that in a little bit. But I started in summer 2015. I started using it for the first 6 months, maybe, at 100% scale, which means everything is teeny tiny. I'm usually up close on my monitor anyway, so I was able to, you know, see everything for the most part, but it was hard. Things are teeny tiny, and I just zoom in on everything in Chrome. For the next year or so, I moved up to 125% scaling, and then for the past 9 months to a year, I've been using 150% scaling, and that is what I have stuck with and found to be comfortable for me. My vision isn't perfect at 4K. But Windows scaling sucks. It's much better than it was in like Windows 7. At Windows 10, it's obviously the best it's been. And so native, you know, good programs and built-in Windows programs scale okay, but text does not always scale right. Text boxes get completely jacked up, where in some programs the text is completely cut off and out of the bounding box and you can't resize the window. You're just stuck with that and a lot of really frustrating things. The cursor doesn't get big enough and a lot of icons get really jacked and the scaling is just inconsistent. It's really confusing. It doesn't work very well. And if you have two different monitors like I do, I have three different size monitors, 1080p, 4K, and 1440p right now. So I don't have 150% scaling on all of them because 150% scaling at 1080p would just be unusable almost. Programs get confused to all hell going between them. And so 4K and 1440p, 150% scaling, 100% scaling, programs get completely jacked up. And then when I'm using Premiere, which I have two monitors full of panels and stuff for, the one on my main monitor is scaled, the one on the next one isn't, and sometimes it gets confused about what size it's supposed to be. And Adobe programs are still actually pretty bad for scaling. I have been following a thread basically since I started using 4K back in 2015 of a request for Photoshop to support 150% scaling, 125% scaling, something. Because at the moment, it's either auto, which for me just means half the time it opens scaled up, half the time it doesn't, which is really frustrating, or 100% or 200%. Nothing in between. And 200% scaling at 4K is honestly too much for most people, especially the smaller screen you get. You have like one tiny little edit window and a bunch of panels, and it doesn't work out very well. And so I'm not a fan, and apparently neither are a lot of other people, and Adobe just kind of hasn't implemented it. I understand that it's apparently pretty complicated since Windows can't get it right, but It's been really frustrating, and that is my biggest reason why I'm leaving it. Well, not the biggest reason. The biggest reason is because I got an insane, just once-in-a-lifetime deal of a fraction, a tiny fraction of the price to pay for an Acer Predator XB271HU, which is a 1440p, 144 hertz, overdrivable up to 165 hertz G-Sync monitor. My first G-Sync experience, my first probably over 100 hertz monitor experience, and it's a beauty and the best monitor I will have ever owned to date, and I'm paying a tiny, tiny price for it. Nope. So I recorded this while things were still happening and I was still being promised the monitor, but good old Staples has decided that they are not responsible for what is on their website. And even more so, it turns out that they don't even sell the Acer Predator XB271HU monitor. I believe that's the model number. They don't even sell it at all, that it was listed falsely by a third-party seller that they go through, because their site's basically like Amazon, and that they're not responsible for it. So I just ended up with a refund and no monitor. So this upgrade isn't actually happening immediately. I have picked up a nice 17-inch 20 or 85 hertz CRT monitor I've been enjoying, which I'll have a separate video on. But for the time being, this change actually isn't happening, but I still want to talk about why I'm looking forward to it. I have been pressing on some Acer and Asus contacts to try to get a replacement monitor for the one that I was trying to get and to make this happen, but I did want to clarify that this pricing error thing did not happen, and you can see in the left-hand side of the screen there is the 21-inch they kept sending me and a friend for the pricing error, trying to claim that it was the Predator. So just wanted to clarify that nonsense. Better yet, it's still listed for $150 on their website, but they literally don't sell the damn monitor. And the actual model number, like it says Acer Predator XB271HU in the title, but the actual where it says item and model number is for an Acer B6 21-inch 1080p monitor. But they still list it as the XB whatever for $150 now. It's even cheaper than the supposed pricing error that I got to pay for it. This is so ridiculous. If you want to see a separate video on my experience, this was a month-long ordeal with this, let me know. But, yeah. But then, what allowed me to say, okay, that means I need to pull the 4K monitor out of my main setup and be done with it for now, whether it goes to a secondary setup, to my fiance's gaming rig, whatever, has been the window scaling stuff. I am actually excited and looking forward to having 1440p on this main monitor again. It means for videos, I won't get as many complaints of people being like, I can't see what's on the screen, even though I zoom in when you do need to see something. Still get lots of complaints. If I can't see what you're doing, why would you record this resolution? I can record 1440p, upscale it nicely and cleanly with a high bitrate to 4K, and still zoom in on the parts, and it should look pretty good. And the high refresh rate nature means that my mouse scrolling around the cursor should actually look a little bit smoother, which will be kind of nice. I have loved gaming at 4K. I gamed at 4K on my 970 before I got my new computer. I game a lot at 4K, or pretty much everything at 4K now with my GTX 1080. It is nice, but there's a couple myths here. Not a couple myths. The main myth is that you don't need anti-aliasing, AA, at 4K. You absolutely do. You absolutely need anti-aliasing. Despite the fact that everyone says the pixel density is so high you don't need it, you won't tell it, there are jagged edges and little lines and UI elements and things like that that look jagged as hell, and you will notice it. You will absolutely notice it. If anything, I feel like I notice some things more since everything is so much sharper. You can see when things stand out as just being outright jagged. Now, the benefit is that due to the pixel density, you can use something lighter like FXAA instead of MSAA 50 times or whatever. But it is still necessary, and that is a big performance hit that everyone assumes you don't need. Not to mention the fact that all the benchmarks these days say, you know, you don't need AA, so that skews performance one way, and then they run everything at Ultra when games aren't supposed to be run at Ultra. Ultra is the, in 10 years, see how good your computer is now setting, not running everything at it. And so if you can run games at 4K at like medium or high, that's fine, but games look much better at 1440p at high or very high or whatever instead. And frankly, I'm just looking forward to having the 144 hertz. I have used high refresh rate monitors in the past, but they were all CRT. I've played at CRTs that have probably gone up to 100 hertz, but I've not played on a greater than 144 hertz monitor, nor G-Sync. I've never seen G-Sync in person at all, and I am super stoked for that. Now, ironically with all of this, I'm also getting a fourth monitor in place here. I still got to figure out how I'm going to set it up on the desk, but I am getting a CRT monitor. It is an IBM E74M. Nothing super fancy, but it will do 1280 by 1024 at 85 hertz, which will be pretty nice and a subject for some videos since I have been messing around. You can see two CRT TVs here, but I don't have any monitors at the moment. There are a couple Holy Grail monitors that I've been looking for. I don't actually have them pulled up here. I know one is the GDM FW900. It's a Sony Trinitron monitor. Where the hell is my notepad shortcut? Here we go. That one is like the Holy Grail, but it weighs so much that it's impossible to ship. I had someone in Alaska who was offering to give it to me, but shipping it would be multiple thousands of dollars, and I can't do that. So I need to find it locally if I'm going to find it, which is probably not going to work out. Where is my... Here we go. The HP A7217A, or the Sony GDM FW900, or there's... I don't know if these are computer monitors. Trinitron CPD G520P. There's a Mitsubishi MegaView XC2935C, but I think that one is a TV. And then the Philips Brilliance 109MP. I think that's a computer monitor as well. But on the lookout for those. But in the meantime, I'm going to play around with this IBM and see if it's something that I want to commit to having in my setup. Because I do watch and screw around with a lot of 4x3 content. And frankly, it is a lot more enjoyable to use 4x3 content on a 4x3 screen than on 16x9, because that's what it's made for. Now, talking about these monoprice monitors for a minute, I have a discontinued 1440p 0G monitor, and there's a 0G FreeSync monitor. This is a standard 60 hertz. And then the monoprice 4K Crystal Pro, I believe it was called, 4K monitor. Now, this is 3840 by 2160, not 4096. These are both 60 hertz displays. The 1440p is an IPS display, whereas the 4K is a TN panel. They both have glass like coverings, but the 4K one is way more reflective to bright backgrounds than the 1440p. And frankly, it's really obnoxious. Like, I usually have my blinds open and there's usually light coming from back there and all of that. It's kind of darker now, but usually between that and all the lights I have going on, there's always constant glares and reflections, and it drives me nuts. And the 1440p one doesn't do that. Plus, the colors are better on the 1440p. Now, this 1440p one I picked up as an open box deal from a reseller store we have here locally that gets like pallets of online returns from Amazon and I guess Monoprice. And as long as things seem to work, they sell them for dirt cheap. I got this for probably sub $200, which seemed like a great deal for my first greater than 1080p monitor at the time. And I picked it up, and the only thing wrong with it was the power brick. The casing for it was broken apart, so some gaffer tape to seal it up, and it's worked fine ever since. DVI and VGA connections, but it has an external power brick, which is a hell of an annoyance. It's 27 inches technically, but the bezel makes it like a 29 inch, which is really obnoxious because my monitor arms only support up to 27 inches like most of them do, so they're clanging together and takes up a lot of space. The bezel and chin on it is huge, and up at the top it has this weird cutout as if there was an option for it to come with a webcam built in, but this one does not. Don't know what the hell's up with that. But this one's been a pretty good monitor. It was a great monitor. It serves me well, and I will probably be using it alongside the new 1440p monitor I'm getting. And it was pretty well, it's a pretty good monitor. Like, I have no major complaints. The colors are nice. It looks great. There are no built-in speakers, though. But everything about it, for the most part, is okay other than the giant-ass bezel. Now, it has the old Monoprice logo on it. Flip over to the 4K panel. It has the new Monoprice logo on it. And it has a smaller bezel. It has built-in speakers. It supports up to two display ports, and they both have DisplayPort 1.2. And then it has HDMI with MHL, which was a big deal, even though Samsung is dumb. So none of my phones have ever really supported it. And it's worked all right. Again, it's a 4K 60 hertz with DisplayPort 1.2. But if I plug in two DisplayPort connections for two different computers or inputs, it downs everything. It forces everything to 30 hertz, and I've never gotten that fixed. And then I have had issues over the past 2 to 3 years of it just randomly, whenever I launch a game, when it has to reset the input, whenever I turn it off and back on, or whenever I turn on my computer, sometimes it will send my computer to tell it to send it 30 hertz, and it will lock itself to 30 hertz until I power cycle it. Don't know why. It's always done that, and like I said, it does the same thing if I feed it more than one DisplayPort input. So that has been incredibly frustrating. Now, it does have picture-in-picture with the HDMI inputs, so that was pretty cool. Before I had my full streaming setup put together, I was using the picture-in-picture with the HDMI to stream from my computer. It was from my game console. It was fairly small, but it worked out pretty well. And over Overwatch thinks the 4K panel is 70 hertz. If I set it to display-based frame limiting, it thinks it's 70 hertz and I get all kinds of tearing. If I set it to 60 FPS, it has some weird jitter issues. So, don't know what's up with that. So, I'm very much looking forward to G-Sync to hopefully smooth out a lot of these issues. Now, lastly, I wanted to address the myth that people have already probably commented, of which I'm going to just delete the comments, to be honest, that you need a 40-inch screen to use 4K. I will reference you here a video feed of my old setup from 2011 where I did use a 40-inch TV as my main computer monitor. Granted, it was 1080p, but I did use it and it was an awful experience. It's not ergonomic at all. And obviously you can set it further back, but using a desktop computer from that far back just doesn't make any sense. I don't have the space for it. It's not realistic. It doesn't make any sense, but everyone's like, oh, mathematically, that's the best PPI, you know, pixel density that you can get on. That doesn't matter for desktop usage. That's fine for, you know, a 40-inch 4K TV is great. 40-inch 4K monitor doesn't make any sense. And it's all about the screen resolution gains, which I've greatly appreciated personally at 4K, which everyone watching my videos has not, since that means everything looks tiny on video. I've appreciated it, but it's not worth the trade-off currently for the scaling issues. So I am currently handing in my Pixel Junkie card between my revamped interest in VHS tapes and that aesthetic, my interest in the CRT monitors and TVs, and now swapping out my 4K for a 1440p monitor. I'm handing in my Pixel Junkie card, and I'm revoking that status for now since I am giving up on 4K for desktop usage. My videos, other than this one, since it's obviously a weird webcam test at 1080p here, my videos will still be 4K for like 99% of them. I'll still watch 4K media, especially on YouTube. I'll still watch 4K Blu-rays whenever that makes sense, and so on. But for the most part, for desktop usage, I am giving up on 4K. I am interested in having a discussion about this in the comments below, as long as you're not going to peddle the same. You know, to me, the 40-inch 4K thing is along the lines of, human eye can't see more than 30 FPS, human eye can't tell the difference between 1080p and 4K. Those kinds of myths, that's what the 40-inch thing is for me, so I don't just get out if you're going to comment that. But if you want to have a legit discussion, please comment down below. Very interested to talk about this. Otherwise, hit the like button if you enjoyed. Don't forget to subscribe. Come check us out on Patreon. And I will see you in the next video. Hopefully this time it works, since I forgot to record audio the first time. EposVox is a Patreon-supported production. Our videos would simply not be possible without the support and generosity of our patrons, whom you can see on screen right now. If you'd like to join the inner circle and get early access to videos, among other things, go to patreon.com/EposVox to learn more.